very clear. I have never discussed with Christian Dawkins paying DeAndre Ayton to attend the University of Arizona. In fact, I never even met or spoke to Christian Dawkins until after DeAndre publicly announced that he was coming to our school. Any reporting to the contrary is inaccurate, false, and defamatory. I'm outraged by the media statements that have been made and the acceptance by many that these statements were true. There was no such conversation.
Welcome to SI Now. I'm Robin Lundberg here with Amy Campbell. And Amy, nothing vague about that denial from Arizona head coach Sean Miller.
Oh, definitely not. In a time where we often see very vague statements from coaches that come out, that was as clear as it could get. I don't know if I remember any coach ever accused of anything being that specific in a denial. And I think it says a lot that the university called this press conference for him. You know, they put him on ice for a week. They do their investigation. He comes out and says all these very specific things. If there was a chance that there was him on a recording that could possibly see the light of day at any point in time, we would have never heard this.
Yeah, here's the thing. We talked about the report earlier, and you assume it's true because right. They're saying there's a recording that exists. So for Miller to go out and say what he did there, he would have some gall to be lying about it now, knowing that there may be the existence of his voice on tape. And if you're the university, I have to imagine you would do your due diligence, and therefore they must believe him. And we have reporting here from SI that it wasn't actually him on the tape, and we'll welcome in our legal analyst Michael McCann right now. Michael, you wrote about the possibility of Miller suing ESPN for this report. How viable would a lawsuit be?
Well, he could bring a lawsuit, but there are a lot of hurdles with a defamation lawsuit that would make it potentially too deterring for him to bring it. So, for instance, he has to prove that it's untrue. Our reporting, as you noted, Robin, indicates that the phone calls that was recorded was not in 2016, but in 2017, and did not involve Ayton. It referred to a different player. But obviously he has to show that in court, and he doesn't have access to the FBI records that are under seal. Secondarily, he has to show that he's been defamed. I think he actually would have a good argument there because his name has gone through the mud over the last week. But the real hurdle would be what's called the actual malice standard. He's a public figure. He has to show that publication of this information was done either knowing it was false or the publisher didn't care at all, had recklessness as to whether or not the information was true or false. That's a high threshold to show. Also, it's worth noting, if he brings a suit, he has to testify under oath. If there are other things that aren't good, that could come out. So, you know, one only goes into peril if they bring a defamation lawsuit. They better be fully clean, even if, in fact, the specific allegation here, he denies in our reporting, indicates is wrong.
From what you reported, Michael, were there any payments discussed at all?
Well, whether or not payments were discussed in regards to a different player is something that I think could come out at some point, perhaps, but it's certainly no phone call that involved Ayton and payments, our reporting indicates, occurred.
Michael, you talk about how difficult it would be to win a defamation lawsuit, obviously a lot against Sean Miller and DeAndre Ayton in that case. Should we expect them to come out of this unscathed?
You know, that's a good question. I mean, I think there's a lot going on with Arizona that could still get the school potentially in trouble. We know that an assistant coach was charged. If the assistant coach was out there doing things in violation of NCAA rules, the program itself could be held responsible. So I think, you know, getting over this hurdle for Sean Miller is certainly really good for him. And he may ultimately be cleared of any wrongdoing whatsoever, but the program itself, given that it involves other people, including assistant coaches, we'll see whether or not that the program comes out clear as well.
Michael, always appreciate your insight. We'll continue to talk to you as this story evolves. Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, the 76ers perhaps took the LeBron sales pitch up a notch on Thursday night by beating LeBron's Cavs 108-97, despite James dropping 30. We saw earlier this week a Philadelphia company took out three billboards hoping to lure LeBron to join the process. So, Robin, do you think this win makes Philadelphia look more enticing to the King?
Well, the things that were enticing are still enticing, and that's the talent that Philadelphia has, namely Joel Embiid and Ben Simmons. Of course, they have been very flexible throughout this process, so they have cap space and all that. But I don't know if it's the perfect fit. I mean, you take LeBron, Embiid, and Simmons, and that's probably maybe the top three talent that any team would have across the entire NBA. Particularly, though, Simmons and LeBron, I don't know if they mesh perfectly the way they complement each other. And then there's the aspect of it being entertaining to watch the Sixers grow without LeBron. They don't need LeBron to become a great storyline. I'm sure their fans would like to go immediately to the finals. But to see Simmons and maybe Fultz if he can get on track, and then, of course, Embiid flourish, I think we all like that team that was tanking getting to a level through that plan. So I would kind of like to see that personally. And you watch Joel Embiid play. I mean, as big as his personality has been, his game matches up.
Delightful.
He stalks down guys on defense. He's hitting those fadeaways a la Hakeem Olajuwon. So I'd like to see the process play out. And I don't know if LeBron has to be involved. It's more intriguing to me to see LeBron somewhere else rather than Philly.
Yeah, I think Embiid is a delight in every way. And I think maybe if LeBron goes there, he could teach him how to be less annoying on Twitter. I don't know.
You think he's annoying?
LeBron, I think LeBron's a little indulgent for my taste.
Joel, you mean?
No, I think Joel's amazing. I think LeBron's a little indulgent.
Oh, LeBron's annoying on Twitter, too.
I think Joel could teach LeBron how to be
gotcha.
A little bit less annoying, because I think he's funny, he's clever, I love his style there. But I think it's intriguing to talk about, right? Like, I do think it would be interesting to see these young guys develop on their own, but I think it would be an interesting thing to talk about. Like you said, they have a lot of pieces that LeBron would be interested in, and it's very clear that it's not working in Cleveland, even though he has a whole new team and it's been about 5 minutes. It's not working. So he's going somewhere. Where is he going? I think it makes sense for him to stay in the East. I think Philadelphia is a long shot, but I think it's definitely a fun discussion to have, and obviously we know they'd like to have him there because they've got those billboards.
And if you talked about social media combinations, I mean, LeBron and Joel Embiid would be the mega powers.
That would be everything.
Colliding. From one possible LeBron suitor to another, the Lakers have now won 4 in a row after dispatching the Heat, and their young core has been playing very well. Lonzo Ball in particular, with Coach Luke Walton saying, quote, "He was great. To me, he was probably the best player on the court tonight, and I think he only shot 5 times. Which is why we've been so high on him from day one. He's one of the very unique players. It doesn't matter if he's taking shots, scoring 20 a game or not. He can impact the game from all over. He was doing that for us tonight, all around, probably, in my opinion, the best player on the floor tonight." You know, the Lakers are playing well enough where I would imagine Luke Walton is now immune from any LeVar Ball criticisms. But when it comes to Lonzo Ball, has he made the early season bust talk look stupid?
I mean, I think that comment from Coach there says it all. And this is on a night where IT drops 29, Julius Randle has 25, and he's saying Lonzo's the best player on the court because he's the one who makes everyone better and he can impact the game in so many different ways. And for as selfish and self-indulgent as LeVar Ball is, Lonzo is the complete opposite. He's not attention-seeking. He doesn't care about the stats. And I think guys really like to play with them. They like his attitude. They like his vibe, his unselfishness, and his basketball IQ. He sees the floor really well, and he brings the level of everyone up around him. They've won 4 straight since he's been back. I think that I'm really excited to see how this guy develops.
Yeah, I mean, there were comparisons to Jason Kidd earlier that many scoffed at, but some of that's kind of valid. And remember, early in his career, it was Ayton Kidd because he said it was no Jay. And that was the problem with Lonzo. He was a self-check at the beginning of the season. Now he's hitting those open threes. He doesn't have to put up 30 a game because he impacts the game in so many other ways, grabbing the rebound and pushing it in transition, outlet passes, playing defense with that long frame. You add Ingram's improved play, Kuzma, and all of a sudden, the Lakers' future looking a lot brighter than maybe it did even a month ago.
Oh, absolutely. And I'm always excited to talk about Lonzo for a basketball reason and not a reality show reason. So I'm really excited to see how things go there. Well, Robin, it is one of my favorite days of the year because the NFL Combine workouts get started. But Thursday in Pete Carroll's press conference, the Seahawks coach made some comments that could suggest defensive end Michael Bennett won't be back in Seattle next year. Carroll said he hasn't talked to Bennett in a while and that conversations are going in all directions this time of year. Now, Bennett has been a key piece of this Seattle defense. Do you think that they're now heading into a time where it's going to be a rebuild there?
It does feel like it, right? But I can't say for sure they're in a rebuild because Russell Wilson and Pete Carroll are still there. So if you have a quarterback and a coach like that in place, you can always maybe retool, though the Legion of Boom was known as maybe the driving force of that team. But football is odd in the sense of it's the sport that maybe we talk about the most and understand the least. What I mean by that is there's so many moving parts that affect the game, right? And there will be players on your favorite team's roster who you might not know going into the season who wind up flourishing and helping the team win. So perhaps Seattle's able to retool personnel-wise, but it does feel like some of their big names on the defensive side are moving along or could be moving along, and that does signal a bit of a rebuild.
I think that is the key word there. It's the defense. It's the defense that is looking like it's going to be a rebuild. We've been talking actually about this for a couple of months, that it feels like the era of the Legion of Boom is over. We saw Richard Sherman's season ended on a torn Achilles. Cam Chancellor missed the end of the season with a neck injury. Earl Thomas is going into the last year of his contract. There's talks that he may not show up unless he gets an extension. These guys that we know, these icons of this Legion of Boom defense, of course, that's more in the secondary. That's not including Michael Bennett. But they're getting older. They're getting injured. They're turning, Sherman, Chancellor, and Thomas turning 29, 30, and 30. Michael Bennett's 32 years old, and his production hasn't gone down. He had 8.5 sacks last year, which was second highest on the team. He's been in the Pro Bowl the last couple of years. But I think that it might be time to move on before that production goes down. You want to get ahead of that. As sad as it makes me to say that, because, gosh, this defense was so awesome, I think maybe it is time for them to move on.
Well, they say 30 is the new 20, but when it comes to professional sports, 30 is the new 40. Yeah. Now, the seemingly perpetually rebuilding Miami Dolphins, who reportedly have given wide receiver Jarvis Landry permission to seek a trade despite putting the franchise tag on him last month, well, should a team like, say, the Carolina Panthers target Landry if he's available?
I think that that is a great idea. My only concern would be a potential personality clash with Jarvis Landry and Cam Newton off the field. I think that they both kind of have that similar. They're both emotional guys, and I don't know if I see that working together that way. But I think that Carolina needs a number one receiver. They had never really replaced Kelvin Benjamin. Devin Funchess is a solid number two. I think that he will flourish much more in that number two role, and they need that guy who's going to be the number one guy. And when you look at the draft this year, there are a lot of good receivers, but there's not that like dominant guy. So I think potentially exploring an option like Jarvis Landry would make sense for this team.
Anytime I hear that there could be a stud receiver available, the first team I do think of is the Carolina Panthers, because there is no team in the league, maybe other than Russell Wilson, maybe it's Seattle who we were just talking about in Carolina, who relies so much on one player for all of their offense. And Cam Newton, I don't think has ever had that sort of target. I don't think Benjamin is of that caliber. So, yeah, of course it makes sense if he's available for Carolina to pursue that sort of deal.
The NFL Combine is underway, and here to join us for some analysis is NFL wide receiver coach and president of D-Rab Sports Fitness and Training, David Robinson. Now, David, you've had some of your players get drafted in the first round. You've worked with such players as Denver's Emmanuel Sanders and Washington's Jordan Reed. Now, overall this year, this is a tight group of receivers when it comes to the rankings in this NFL draft. How do you coach your guys to separate themselves?
Well, one thing that I do, especially with college receivers coming out for the NFL draft, a lot of them, when they come in and out of their breaks, they cruise and they relax out of their cuts. So one thing that separates the guys that I train, getting them ready for the draft, is getting them pro ready, and that's the top end of their routes, finishing them and staying fast and explosive out of their cuts. So that's what really separates them, because not a lot of college receivers finish their routes when they come out of their breaks, when they're getting ready for the draft, because they're not used to it.
Well, there are a lot of things that scouts and coaches are looking for when they evaluate these guys. What are the most common mistakes that you see athletes commit at the combine?
The interview process. A lot of guys don't really know how to answer the questions when scouts are being, you know, interviewing you, and they already know the truth. So a lot of players, sometimes they go in there thinking that they don't know, and they lie about certain things. That's off the field. On the field, I see a lot of guys getting ready for the 40, which is great because you need a good time. But when it comes to sinking their hips, dropping their weight, stopping on the dime, when it comes to running routes, that's what you have to do at the combine. And they don't harp on that enough. So that's why some guys, they go to the combine and they look good running the 40, but they don't look really good running their routes all the time.
Well, you're working with some elite talent this year, including Calvin Ridley from Alabama. From what you've seen of Ridley, what makes him so special?
He's really smooth. He's really polished. He's very explosive in and out of his breaks. He has great ball skills. Alabama, they run a pro-style offense, and they run the ball quite a bit. So the numbers are down, but he's a prolific wide receiver. The teams that I see him going to that can really use him are the San Francisco 49ers. They don't have a premier receiver, you know, in their building. I also like the Oakland Raiders as well. For him, because, you know, Crabtree might not be back, and then Amari Cooper, he struggled this past year, so I think that'll be a good fit for him. But any team that needs a number one receiver, I believe he will fit into their scheme because he can, you know, translate to any routes that they're going to want him to do because he already pretty much knows the route tree because they run that at Alabama, so he's not going to have a problem adjusting.
All right, we'll see if Oakland ends up as Alabama receiver U at the next level. We talk a lot about Ridley, obviously, plenty of buzz around him, but you're working with a lot of other talented guys. Which guy has stood out to you that we might be overlooking? Who are we not talking about here?
A guy that, you know, a lot of people need to know about is Richie James out of Middle Tennessee State. He's a projected third through fifth round pick. And some reporters has him down as the next Antonio Brown. This kid is really electrifying. He's cat quick. He'll probably be one of the top slot receivers drafted this year. I think he's going to have a great showing at the combine. So that's a guy, that's a name to look out for, is Richie James out of Middle Tennessee State.
All right, and we've got those wide receiver workouts coming up this weekend. Going to be a lot of eyes there. Who's a guy who's going to test really well? Who's going to blow up at the combine?
I think my guy, Christian Kirk. I think Christian Kirk is going to really surprise a lot of people. A lot of scouts think that he's not that fast. They think that he's a 4.5 guy. But I think he's going to run in the 4.3, 4.4 range and run really good routes and surprise a lot of scouts with his change of direction. Another receiver that I trained that's going to blow up the combine is Cortland Sutton out of SMU. He's 6'4", about 230, 225 pounds, and he can move like he's a smaller receiver, like 5'10", 5'11". So I think scouts are going to really fall in love with how well he gets in and out of his cuts.
I also want to ask you about Antonio Callaway out of Florida there, a guy with a ton of potential who never really blossomed in college because of off-the-field issues and a lot of complications there. Can he reach his potential at the next level?
I definitely believe he can reach his potential. His agent and his team that's around him are going to have to, you know, have a tight-knit team around him, making sure that he stays out of trouble and things like that. But I think it's a guy that might slide probably fourth round, third round, but has first-round talent. But I definitely think he has a chance to excel at the next level, but it's all about who he puts in his circle to keep him out of trouble. That's the main thing that he has to work on.
All right, we'll be keeping an eye on your guys at the combine this weekend and leading up to the draft. David Robinson, thanks so much for the insight.
Thanks for having me.
I'm here with WWE star Luke Harper, and I guess technically movie star now, too, in the new film Mohawk. March 2nd, it's out 2018, also on VOD and digital. First of all, since you have this new movie out,
yes.
Who do you think is the second best wrestler turned actor, assuming you think The Rock is number one?
Well, I was going to say me number one, uh-huh. Rock number two, but maybe we'll go me number one, Rock number two, The Miz third.
The Miz is in third place.
But just because he does so much. Not quality, it's quantity for him.
All right, so you're a solid second, though.
Or one.
Okay, yeah, move it up. We'll give you number one. You're here right now. I'm not going to say otherwise.
Rock.
Yeah, I'm not going to say it to your face, right? All right, now, aside from the physical, you know, aspects mm-hmm. in the ring, mm-hmm. what is different about the performance that you give in the WWE versus acting?
So, to me, it was I go from a wrestling ring where I do a motion, and it's instant gratification from the crowd, whether cheering, booing, or silence, whereas you make a movie and you do a scene and then the director, Ted, hi Ted, he'll say, okay, we're done, next. And I say, hey, was that okay? And there's nobody to say, yeah, that was great, until the movie comes out, like now, where people can then say, oh yeah. So it's a 2-year process of gratification as opposed to 1 minute.
No pop from the director?
No. Not enough for me.
Now, you're known for your ability to connect with the fans mm-hmm. without necessarily mm-hmm. saying that much in the ring. What was it like to deliver some of the big lines in the film?
For me, it was great. And, you know, a learning experience too, because like I don't do it that much. So being able to talk and to be articulate and to show and to get a message across verbally was totally different for me, and like very helped me going back into the WWE world as well.
So you think doing this has actually prepared you better for your career?
Absolutely. I think they're all kind of intertwined, different worlds, but intertwined. And I think whatever I'm doing here is helping me in WWE, and whatever I'm doing in WWE is going to help me here in the future.
Interesting.
If there's a future.
Piggybacking off that a little bit, Ronda Rousey just made her debut in the WWE, and there was some criticism about her mic skills.
Right.
Given what you just said, what would your advice be on how she can improve in that area?
Here's the thing. If you watch Ronda's UFC fights, the way she talks is absolutely fine to me, and I think the build-up to those fights were great. And I think that when she understands the WWE game more, and again, I don't think anything was wrong with the way she spoke, but it's the way she speaks, and she's a threat. And so if someone has a problem with that, go ahead and tell her. She'll take your arm home.
Yeah, put you in that arm bar.
Absolutely.
I'm sure we might see that at WrestleMania. Now that's on the way. Many are predicting yourself and your partner, Eric Rowan, will be primed to have a spot there. How motivated are you both to have that iconic WrestleMania moment?
Let me tell you, man, it's the end-all, be-all to make that walk at WrestleMania. I've done it once before in San Francisco, and it's the end of the game for me and Rowan to make that walk. So to say if we don't, it would be a monumental disappointment. And so if we don't, it's going to be tough. But we plan on doing something.
Also some talk about who John Cena might be facing. Mm-hmm. Who would you like to see him face?
Me. Other than that, hopefully The Undertaker. Other than that, we'll see.
All right, so you would take out John Cena at WrestleMania?
100%. If, like I said, I'm looking for a spot, and if the spot's not open with Rowan, then I would love to have that spot with Cena.
All right, what about the Undertaker? There's a little talk, a little worry maybe he should stay retired. You'd want to see him in the ring?
Oh, yeah. I'm not going to sit here and tell The Undertaker to stay retired. And if you want to do that, go ahead.
Well, he's not here. It's a little safer for me to say that to
him. You don't know where he is.
Yeah, he could pop up out of anywhere, right? I mean, I've seen that before.
Absolutely.
All right, now you're also known for your beard, of course. So I want to show you some other famous beards.
Okay.
And get your reaction, just your grooming reaction, how good you think it is. Maybe the most famous beard in sports
right
now.
I'll tell you this, because right before I came in here, the lady who was doing makeup wanted to run a comb through it, and I wouldn't let her. So I think I'm doing good.
No, like unkempt is your look.
Well, it's like getting fat. You just kind of have it, and my beard is fat right now.
All right, James Harden, the most famous beard in sports.
I mean, clean cut, tight, doesn't do it for me. Next.
All right, we've got Houston Astros, Dallas Keuchel.
See, now that's actually in his early stages. He got a little deeper than that, so I approve of Dallas.
All right, and then Brent Burns of the San Jose Sharks.
Brent Burns, good friend. Man.
Good
He might have me. He's got better teeth than me. Man, he's a great-looking guy.
Now, why is Harden's beard lagging behind these other guys, Keuchel
and Burns?
Well, the
thing is, if you look here, he keeps it real tight here, and then he'll tighten it up at the bottom. That doesn't fly with us. So if you look at Burns, he's unkempt here, unkempt here.
Okay, so you just unkempt is the way.
I mean, if you're taking care of it, something's wrong.
Yeah. If you're kempting it real right here, Luke Harper would say unkempt is the way to go.
Exactly.
All right, now back to the film. Of course, it means Mohawk for you. What would you like fans to come away with after watching the movie?
So I'm super proud of the entire project and the way it came out. And I believe that it's steeped in historical reality. And I think once people see it, they'll understand the political ramifications of what happened then in the War of 1812 and what's happening now in today's world. And I feel like it's an entertaining piece that also has political ramifications. And I think that's very important.
Would you consider doing more? Or is that something you want to do more of?
Love to. Absolutely love to. The process was fascinating from beginning to end. And like I said, to see it come out now and to understand what we put into it and to see the movie on the screen, it's unbelievable.
In addition to wrestling?
Yes. I would love to do it all.
All right. Luke Harper, WWE superstar, and of course, in the new movie, Mohawk. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
It's time for SI Now's Weekend Drive, presented by Toyota. Let's go places. First, we head to Indianapolis for the NFL Combine. All eyes have been on Saquon Barkley, who put up 29 reps on the bench. Speculation as to where he'll be picked, but Barkley expressed his opinion about being drafted by the Browns.
I think they're a couple pieces away. They do have a lot of young talent, bringing in a new offensive coordinator. They are a good team. If you look at the schedule, obviously they won one game, but they're in a lot of games. So. You want to be part of something like that. That's something bigger than yourself. That's something that you leave a legacy, being part of something special.
The Browns have a similar back in Duke Johnson, but of course could use a talent like Barkley. Next, we head to Houston to see the Celtics take on the Rockets. Boston leads the series after squeaking out the W in Beantown. Celtics head coach Brad Stevens knows he'll have his hands full come tip-off at the Toyota Center.
We had no business winning the game here. When you go back and watch it, I mean, we were very, very fortunate being down 26 at halftime. We did fight. We gave ourselves a chance, and we found a way. But, man, it's a really good team, and it'll be a heck of a test.
With the win, the Celtics can snap the Rockets' 14-game winning streak. Finally, we head to Brooklyn for some heavyweight boxing. Deontay Wilder will face Luis Ortiz for the WBC heavyweight title. Wilder is excited to be facing a great technical fighter in Ortiz and add to his resume being the best heavyweight.
I'm still going to bless him with the opportunity because I feel he's the best. Not to say I'm the best, I know him best, and I want to prove to the world that I am the best heavyweight in the world, the baddest man on the planet.
Wilder is 39-0 with a 97% knockout rate, but Ortiz is no slouch with his 28-0 record. And that's what's in store for this weekend.